The title of the presentation is Citizen Archive, My Precious Information, and the presenter is also from Southeastern Finland University of Applied Sciences, and his name is Ansi, that's easy, and then Jaskelainen.
Yes, I'm okay. Ansi Jaskelainen.
Yeah, that. And I think he prepared this paper with Liisa Uusukainen.
Liisa Uusukainen.
Yeah, okay. And I think only Ansi will present it.
Okay, so thank you. You already heard about the general speak about Citizen Archive, this ideological point of view. And now I'm going to dive a bit deeper. My background is totally technical, but I'm not going too much into technical details. Some, but not too much. Okay, so my CEO author in this paper was Liisa Uusukainen, and we have kind of divided that she goes somewhere and I go somewhere and so forth. So he's back at home doing all the work since we are here. You already heard about Digitalia, what it is, what we do, but if you wish to know more, you can again scan the QR code and check our English website. Lots and lots of information and some nice videos also. Unfortunately, the video is only in Finnish language, but still, it's a nice thing to watch. Okay, so about the starting points for this paper. First of all, nobody cares about your information or your precious data. You do care about your own information, but let me explain this by asking a few more questions from you. So, are you able to get your precious information into some national archive? If I would offer my photographs to National Archive of Finland, they would laugh me out from their building. So no. And then second alternative, has any business archive shown some interest towards your materials? Probably no, unless you are somehow important person. For example, former president or something like that. And then third question, is there any other digital archive that would take your materials? Maybe if you pay enough, but most likely there isn't any. So these are the starting points for the citizen archive development. So we, as normal citizens, we must rely on these USB devices, optical medias, maybe cloud drives. And even with a good will, those cannot be considered as reliable nor archives. Those are storages for data, but nothing more, nothing less. They won't guarantee that your information remains safe. And they won't guarantee that they won't be using it somehow. For example, I don't trust that NSA won't get into my account that is in Google. They probably have some kind of backport. I don't know. Then the second third starting point is ignorance. And by that I mean that nobody cares about what happens to this information until the disaster strikes. For example, I have my hard drives in write one mode, which means mirrored. And then I also have a backup copy on a USB drive, which is separated from the computer. But I didn't do that until the disaster strikes and I lost some of my precious photographs. And after that, I did this kind of archiving solution for me. And also the lack of knowledge, since most of us common folks, we still consider these cloud drives as an archive, which they are not. But still, at the meantime, there is this increased interest towards personal archiving, storing my personal life story, capturing the most valuable artifacts. For example, I think I have almost 300 gigabytes of pictures of my child. So those are one of the most valuable artifacts that I would like to keep safe. We heard yesterday that the amount of digital information is growing exponentially. And that that way is not going to be any other. It will just go up and up and up. Most of the this information is merely junk, but there is this important information also on that mass. So something needs to be done with that. And I think it was Thomas Jefferson that once said that information is the currency of democracy. And he was absolutely right. That's the situation. So therefore we ask that, is it justified that we must rely on these unreliable devices to store our precious information? No, it's not justified. And finally, to make things even more difficult, yes, I know there is Rhoda too, which can be used to store information, but it probably doesn't offer this Google-like UX, which is the minimum that modern end users require. So that's what we are aiming at. Yeah, by the way, I'm going to give a little demonstration that you can also try to use it. And if you wish to use it, please try to take a PST file out from your Outlook, and then you can upload it to our service and see what happens, if you are interested. I will try to demonstrate it here. And you will get the slides later on, so the link will be available also on there. About the Citizen Archive, I won't go into technical details, just show you the programs that are behind it. So it's built about Fedora 3 at the moment. We are trying to migrate into 4, maybe. Then we have implemented some functionalities on top of it by using Java. Databases are managed by MariaDB and Mongo, indexing by Solr, and OpenLDAP is the authentication service. And this is the deepest I go into technical details. But please feel free to contact me afterwards if you wish to know more. And if you happen to know any good ways of migrating from Fedora 3 to 4, then please let us know. We would be truly interested. There's the workflow. So files on computer, then uploaded to Citizen Archive server, virus scanning, preview generation, emails to PDF conversion, and so forth. All kind of things. Happens automatically. All the user have to do is just track the files into our system. That service, as Mikko said, is offered as a software as a service model. So all you have to have is a modern browser and you can access it. I think Internet Explorer 6.5 is not acceptable, but almost anything else is. And at the moment, we also have had one pilot user who has been very active, and he has been preserving his family heritage. Old photographs, probably from the 18th century, the oldest ones. Then he also has shared this information with his relatives so that they can also update some metadata, add some pictures and so forth. And also to keep some kind of up-to-date information available to the members that he has picked. And we actually don't even know what kind of material he keeps in that archive, since he is the archival master, not we. We are just a service provider, as Mikko said. And some feedback from him. So although the system seems to be operating quite nicely, it's still a very time-consuming task to upload all these materials into archive and importing metadata and so on. And this archival terminology. Even though we have been trying to make it as transparent as possible, it's still there. And we will try to get rid of that, so that the end user doesn't even notice that he or she is using an archive. More automation is needed, according to him. I'm not sure what he meant by that. Probably more automation is needed, and we will need to figure it out. But he still said that this service opens a lot of new possibilities, and then maybe in the future, not too very near, this service could complement these official national archives, if those could be connected somehow, maybe with RDF or some other machine-readable language. maybe. Okay, so that's about it. And now I will present these three actual cases that we have been doing. Some of these has already been embedded into the Citizen Archive solution. And this is the one that you are able to test if you would like to do so. But first of all, emails in archive. Why should we do that? Well, I think you all have had this situation. You have some kind of PST file taken from somewhere, but you don't know what to do with it. If you try to double-click it, you will have this if you have Outlook installed. If you don't have Outlook installed, then you probably will get some kind of list of programs that select the one that should open this file. And this is not very transferable, even though some national archives do accept this as long-term preservation format, but we don't. We will convert those to something else. And we actually had a true case behind this. It's the Päivälehti archives, which is part of Helsingin Sanomat Foundation. And they have about 100,000 emails in two very large PST files from the former head journalist. And their noble aim was to release those to the researchers. But in this current format, there was no way that they could have done it. So we came up with a solution. There's a Linux as a backbone. Then we used Python, sort of a duct tape to tape all of these open source programs together. And then some Java to do some specific things. In this case, it was the metadata converting, which was done with Java. I'm not going to go through with these programs, but you can check those. Those are all available online. And if you would like to do our workflow better than we did, please feel free to do so. And now the most exciting part. I'm going to try this. And if you are going to try it, then remember to put this S after this HTTP. Otherwise, it won't work. I surely hope this works. And if you are trying to access it, you will get some security warnings. But that's because it doesn't have a domain name. And secondly, we have self-signed this SSL certificate. So that's why you will get those errors. But still, it is using HTTPS connection. It will take you to this main page, and then by clicking this, you get to enter this. Oh, there's some finished. Okay, but the username was test user, and the password was the same, but replace E's with trees. And I must say that this is a demonstration version, very fastly done, actually, by one of our trainee. So I have nothing to do with this actual website. I'm just using it. I'm sure, hope it works. I have a PST file over here. I'll just drag it over here. So far, so good. Now it... Yes, I think it works. It will produce a star.gzip file, which probably I cannot open with this computer, but I have it right here. I have extracted it. And this is what I got. Every email that was in that PST file was converted into true PDF A3 format file. And yes, these are Finnish emails, but those they are just there. I'm actually very surprised that it worked. Okay, but let's continue. I think I don't have too much more time left anymore. The second thing we did was this automatic PDF splitting. And why we did that was because of this. Download times are hideous. Our cooperator in this pilot was Helsinki City Archives, and they had this huge PDF files in the archive. For example, 466 megabytes with over 1,000 pages. And the download time for that is unacceptable. So we automatically split those into smaller pieces. And again, we used Linux, Python, and some open source programs. In this case, the programs were PDF Toolkit and Coast Script. And we did this by browsing through the internal structure of the PDF file. If you haven't ever done that, you can easily check the internal structure of a PDF file by, for example, downloading Notepad++ program and open the PDF file over there. Then you can see all the bookmark tags and everything that's inside that PDF. That's invisible to the normal user. Then we just scanned through the file. If bookmarks were found, then we splitted that PDF file from that point, and so on. We also did some tests if the bookmarks were not found by automatically OCRing the content and then trying to figure out the correct cutoff points by using some keyboard matrices. With that material, which was old city government records, it's actually worked quite well. The accuracy was something like 70%. And it would have been better if the original scan resolution would have been a bit better. But in the end, these 308 very large PDF files were split into 5,917 smaller PDF files that are a lot easier to share with their end users online also. So the download time reduction in average was about 90%. And we also did some partial sensitive information analysis, but it wasn't a novel approach. We just read it through word by word and compared if some forename or last name was found and then marked it in the document. But in the end, Helsinki City Archives, they were very pleased since they could now release those to the public in a lot more user-friendly way than they did originally. And finally, one more thing that we have done was this automated OCRing. And why? I have noticed that many of you have taken pictures of these slides, this presentation and many others, and you will get a picture. You cannot search the content. But by doing these few simple actions, you can turn those images into a PDF that has this OCR information inside it. ImageMagick is an open source image converter software, and Tesseract is the open source OCRing software. And again, we combine those with a Python, and then using similar command line commands than you can see over there, we turned these PDF files without OCR information into PDF files with OCR information. Very simple and effective. About 5 seconds per page. And all the slides that I have shown here are available on that address, so please feel free to check those, and also please try that our email converter solution. I hope it fails, and then we can check the logs what went wrong, so we can fix it. And any questions, you can point to these emails or ask right now. Thank you.
Questions? Yeah. It's to Ansi as well as to Mikko and Norman. So as far as I can understand, I could in principle be your client of your services as well, or is it for the Finnish people in design?
We can take test users, of course, but it's in Finnish at the moment, so that's a bit restricted.
Actually, I think that part of the UIs has already been transferred into English also. So yes, it's mainly for the Finnish, but there is no obstacle of taking any test users.
Yes, and technically it supports internal nationalization out of the box. You can give any translation, but if you feel like you want to contribute and create translation, you get it faster for your language.
Crowdsourcing.
The buzzword. So any more questions? No, I think. Okay, Ansi, thank you very much.
Okay.